I'm Tracy Ellis, and this is The Elephant in the Dome, the official podcast of the Washington State Senate Republican Caucus. In this episode,
we want to make sure that people do get the right to counsel right away, and also that the victims aren't feeling like, why am I reporting this? Nothing's being done.
A shortage of public defenders is leading to the release of people charged with serious crimes. Senator Nikki Torres joins me now. Some people are calling this a crisis. Do you agree?
It is. It's been an ongoing crisis that's finally getting some attention to it because people are so used to hearing the workforce needs or shortages are in other industries, but not really looking at the courts and the attorneys that we have that are providing services to indigent peoples that are in jail. So it is a crisis. We also have a lot of people that are retiring or just getting burnt out and are leaving in the public defense world. They're tired and they know that they can make more money by opening up their own practice. So we are seeing less and less that are being attracted to offering public defense services.
I heard the public defense attorney shortage recently led to six suspects having their bail eliminated in Benton County. Is that true?
Yes. I did actually speak with the Benton County prosecutor. He spoke at the Benton County commissioners meeting and made all of us aware that they had to release six inmates because they could not assign counsel to them in a timely manner. And one of them was a rapist. And unfortunately, their hands were tied and had to release them. And I think that is an issue that is very alarming, not only for the community, but also for the victims. That is not something that says, hey, we are here to protect you. And not only that, but it also makes our prosecutors look bad, and it's not their fault because they're following the law and they're being told, you know, if you can't assign counsel, then you have to release them. And that is what had to be done. So unfortunately, you know, we're behind the time on trying to mitigate this and make sure that this doesn't continue to happen. But we are going to look at some strategies for long term that will help, you know, for 10 years down the road, possibly. So we've been meeting with this work group to help mitigate this issue. But unfortunately, this happened already.
You touched on this a little bit earlier, but can you talk more about how we got here?
How did we get here? Well, it's been happening over the course of several years. And in the more rural, I would say it hits harder in the more rural areas because you have less public defenders being attracted to the area, and also the pay that they are going to earn is probably less than they're going to earn in Seattle. And the counties are running on a very fine margin and aren't able to attract public defenders or people from the West Side to come back, or students that have gone to school, because you also got to look at where the law schools are at. That's number one. So they're going off to school and sometimes they ain't coming back to the area. So they're not coming back to the rural areas where they're from. They're staying and they're seeing the opportunity in those bigger metropolitan areas. And they're saying, you know what, we're going to stay there. And that's very unfortunate for us because we have this growing population and a lot of it is indigent. And that's what we're seeing in our jails. And we need that we need someone working in those fields of public defense to help represent the indigent people. But unfortunately, they're not coming back. So this has been happening over several years. And I think it's what we're seeing is now that it's really sounding the alarm is when we're seeing that people are being released that shouldn't be released.
What, if anything, can be done to address this public defender shortage issue?
Well, there's always a talk about money. But unfortunately, we tried creating a bill last year that did not even get a hearing to increase the amount that the state is going to reimburse the counties for indigent services to providing counsel for them. And that didn't get very far at all. Like I said, it didn't even get a hearing because of the amount. So it is the state's responsibility to reimburse more because the state is putting this on the counties. So we definitely need to find a better way to reimburse the counties for the services that they are having to foot the bill for. They shouldn't have to pay 100% of it and only get reimbursed 2% by the state. I mean, that's not feasible. And then now if you look at the recent bar, they decrease the caseloads that these public defenders can take on, which for them, in especially in you're looking at the rural areas that they didn't take into consideration. Because remember, the Bar Association is over on the west side. So they probably don't think about the rural areas. They're just looking at the metropolitan areas. And they didn't take into consideration the caseloads that our public defenders are having to take and the lack of public defenders that we have. And now that's going to make it more difficult for them and probably be seeing more people getting released that shouldn't be released.
Senator Nikki Torres with me. You proposed legislation last session to forgive law school loans for public defenders, but it didn't make it into law. Do you plan to reintroduce that?
Yeah, so I just met with the work group day before and we convened and we discussed a little bit more about reintroducing a smaller package, something that would be more, not so much of a shock or something that wouldn't kill the bill and dead on arrival. Because we do feel that that is important in attracting, especially new law student, new law student graduates, to enter the field. And also those seasoned attorneys as well to take on a couple, you know, contract cases. I think that would be beneficial to have something that includes also contract employees, contract public defenders, to be able to get some kind of loan repayment forgiveness. But we're going to try to use the term loan repayment, and hopefully that's a little more appetizing for the legislature this coming session, and also structuring it in a way where it's a little less. So if they're only going to be there 1 year helping out with cases, they're going to get a certain amount for just the 1 year. Or, you know, paying their payment for the month that they're working. One of the other things that we touched on too was looking at other supportive staff that can help, especially with the decrease in caseload that's been being implemented for our public defense and the prosecution. You know, I think a lot of looking at our support staff, such as our paralegal and our law clerks, you know, what all they can help with and take on, and something to help incentivize them as well. I think that's going to be important, especially, again, as I mentioned, that decrease in caseload. That's not the way to go. I know that I get the reason behind wanting that decreased caseload was to, you know, provide some mental health sanity to our public defenders and not burn them out. But actually, this is creating more stress for them because they don't want to get in trouble for taking on additional cases because no one else could. And then having to release people that shouldn't be released. So that's something that we're looking at as well. It's part of our game plan for this work group. But again, money is the big issue. If they had all the money in the world, they could probably pay their public defenders a little more and attract those students to come back from law school. And the other area, I would say the final area that we're looking at is talking with some of our local community colleges, four-year, because we now have Columbia Basin College that is a four-year college as well. About a possible law program there, because I know that Heritage University is in the area, but they only offer a pre-law program, so it's not a full-blown law program. And hopefully we can entice some of them to start offering that to keep students here and not having to leave and also come back into the workforce to meet that workforce need.
You did get a bill passed that pays for training public defenders and prosecutors in rural areas, right?
Yeah. So, well, I was really excited to see that the bill passed this past session and, you know, for being such a short session, but it was only able to fund about 12 people. So 12 interns to get that experience in public defense and also in those that are seasoned attorneys to dive into public defense and prosecution training. So it was only a total of 12 people. So I'm looking forward to having an increase in that area, but also in the funding for that, because we want to see more people participating in that program.
I can't imagine that this is a partisan issue.
Exactly. It's not a partisan issue. This is a people issue. This is a victims issue. And, you know, we want to make sure that people do get the right to counsel right away. And also that the victims aren't feeling like, why am I reporting this? Nothing's being done. And the person's just coming right back out. And the offender sometimes, you know, they're saying, oh, well, I'm just going to get a slap in the hand and then I'm going to get released. So we don't want that mentality to keep happening. We want there to be accountability, but we also want to make sure that people are being represented and that our prosecutors' hands aren't tied, and or that our police officers aren't going out there and arresting people and then realizing, well, they're just getting released.
That's Senator Nikki Torres, and this is The Elephant in the Dome, the official podcast of the Washington State Senate Republican Caucus. I'm Tracy Ellis.